The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
Off the Record with Zhivargo Laing is sponsored by Royal Fidelity Bank and Trust, Burger King, Royal Star Assurance, Cable Bahamas, Rev Christmas, the Ministry of Health, and AML Foods Limited.
Welcome, welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Wednesday afternoon. I trust and hope that you are doing well. If you want to give us a call today on the show, I want to give you the numbers at the beginning. You can call us on 323-6232. That's 323-6232. Or 325-4316, 325-4316, or 325-4259, that's 325-4259. You can also text us on 422-4796, that's 422-4796, or you can WhatsApp me on 439-3043. We are, of course, live on Cable Bahamas, channel 969. That's the way my mother listens to the show. Or you can catch us on BTC Flow, channel 612. That's BTC Flow, channel 612. So I have an interesting, I think, question for you today. If you pick up the Nassau Guardian today, you will see that the former Prime Minister, Hubert Alexander Ingram, is having a row with a knight. The knight being Sir Franklin Wilson. So the former Prime Minister is rebuffing claims made by Sir Franklin that his government's handling of a, say, like the Samianto proposed deal back in the 90s, there in Eleuthera, one was a reflection of bad public policy, in Sir Franklin's words, and the governance, in Sir Franklin's words. And that the consequence of that, 96, 97, in particular years, Sir Franklin noted, was to thrust Eleuthera into recession. According to the Nassau Guardian, Sir Franklin said that the owners of Cotton Bay were ready to go, but, end quote, by Sir Franklin, bad public policy and governance is what derailed this thing in 96 and 97. And in my humble opinion, he said, triggered the recession Eleuthera has not come out of. That is a huge, huge allegation, huge challenge. In essence, Sir Franklin is saying that the way the Ingram administration handled that particular investment is the reason why, in his words, Eleuthera has remained from 1996, 1997 votes in recession. That is a really, that's a hugely sharp criticism and charge to make. Mr. Ingram disagreed vehemently with him. Okay, Mr. Ingram suggested that the F&M administration's policy was pro-development, and that the reason why the purchase the proposed purchase of the Eleuthera land by Samiantos from Franklin Wilson and those then was because it was not attached to any development proposal for that foreign investor. So Mr. Ingram's charge was that whatever Sir Franklin was saying, was describing as bad policy, his government did not consider it bad policy to not have an investor purchase huge blocks of land without any development proposal attached to it. In the quote, we were satisfied that additional land was not required. So the investor had land, mind you. Okay, the investor had land. Said that we were satisfied that the additional land was not required for the size development proposed. And further, we did not agree that foreign entities or persons should be approved by the government to purchase large tracts of vacant land without specific approved development plans. That's according to the NASA data from state. So in other words, Mr. Ingram and Sir Franklin are having a row over policy, public policy. Just before Juan McCartney's show ended, Anton called to claim that the way the Minnis administration handled the port development, the port deal, that it was in, he didn't use these words, but what he was saying was it was bad policy. Juan McCartney disagreed. Juan McCartney didn't say it this way, but what Juan McCartney was saying on that instance, it was good policy. There are people who are calling in now and talking that the government is proposing to put in toll booths on the streets in the Bahamas, I'm assuming Nassau, to collect revenue in order to finance the infrastructure of the country. And there are people who disagree with that. What are they disagreeing with? Public policy. So I wanted to anchor our discussions today against the backdrop of those three examples of disagreement or commentary on public policy to ask you this question. Here's what I want to ask you. We're going to get into a couple of things related to some of those, but I want to ask you this question. When we mention policy, when we mention public policy, what we are talking about is how the government addresses a problem or issue in the country. A problem or issue for the country. First, let me tell you that a problem can be a negative thing, meaning it can be that you are trying to keep, you're kind of trying to reduce illegal immigrants to the country. It could be that you are trying to clean bad water. It could be that you are trying to stop fires at a dump, a public dump. It could be that you're trying to educate poor children. So those are problems in the negative sense of the word. But every problem doesn't have to be negative. For instance, you could have 7 million tourists coming here, but your problem is how to get 10 million. So that's not a negative problem. It's a problem of trying to grow. Even though you're growing, even though you have great numbers, you're trying to get more numbers. So some problems you have can be positive problems. They can be development problems. They can be issues requiring solution. Whichever it is, a negative, fix something that's gone wrong, or a positive, make something good better or something better best. Whatever it is, however the government chooses to address it is called a public policy. Sometimes the government can address it by doing something, or it can address it by doing nothing. Either way, whatever the government does or does not do reflects public policy, reflects how the government is addressing that issue. So my question for you today is, look at problems we have in the country that you see and tell me, identify the problem, identify how the government has chosen to deal with the problem, and then tell me why you would do it or why you think the government should change the way it does it. That's a lot. Yeah, well, that's what you got today. What policy of the government of the Bahamas would you change today? What policy, whether it's in education, it's in public health, it's in national security, it's in culture, it's in infrastructure development, it's in economics, it's in immigration, it's in foreign affairs. What policy of our government would you change today if you could change that policy? What policy would you change today if you could change it in some way? That's the question today. That's the question. I'm going to give you some time to think about it. But I do want to make some comments about the cruise port and in the offering. First, let me say, I don't have all the details. I am getting the offering memorandum so I can study it for myself to look at it. On the face of it, I have to say that as a business, the cruise port represents, as I can see it, a viable, sustainable going concern for many years. Why? Because the cruise business is primarily a business of senior citizens. Senior people, elderly people love to cruise. Yes, young people love to cruise too, but elderly people are big, big customers of cruise business. Let me ask you another question. Going forward, is the world going to have more or less elderly people? You get that right. It's going to have more. So chances are, unless something changes in the demand pattern or changes in the appetite of elderly people about cruise, boy, the cruise business is looking on a upward trajectory rather than a downward trajectory. So, and the Bahamas, for more reasons than one, not only is natural beauty, but also its proximity and energy cost saving proposition for cruise liners, represents a prime destination for cruising. That's why you're seeing the interest played in us by Disney, by Carnival, by Royal Caribbean. That's not accidental. That's quite strategic from a corporate business point of view for them. And so it is reasonable to believe that the cruise business has a good upside. And it's reasonable to believe that in the long term, it has a good upside. COVID-19 notwithstanding, it has a good upside. When I think about it, I asked myself only this morning, 5 years from now, what are we likely to be looking at? Will COVID-19 be a headline story 5 years from now? That's what I'm asking myself. And my answer is no, it will not be. In 2027, COVID-19 will not be a headliner. Why? Why do I say that? Well, if one takes into consideration the pace of science and what it has been able to do both in treating COVID and vaccinating from COVID, I am very optimistic that we are going to beat COVID down to a manageable, communicable disease. I'm convinced about that. So 5 years from now, I don't see COVID on the front lines. But there are some other issues, good and not so good, that I see 5 years from now. And we're going to talk about that in another show. But insofar as the cruise business is concerned, I think it has a great upside. And insofar as the cruise business in the Bahamas is concerned, I think it has a great upside. Insofar as the management and operation of the Bahamas is, the Nassau Cruise is concerned, I think it has an upside. Why? It has the management it has sound managers with a sound track record of managing cruise ports. And I think that the proposal, the plans that I have seen for it look really impressive for me and can only enhance our destination as a cruise destination. And so I think it has an upside. Now, this offering that is being put forward, should I jump into it? Should you jump into it, et cetera? Well, listen, every investment proposal matters to one, your objectives in life, your aims, your goals. That's the thing you got to clarify first. What's your objective? Are you trying to build a retirement fund? Are you trying to get some quick money? Are you trying to build a diversified portfolio for yourself? Are you trying to put something away for your children's education? Whatever your goals are, that matters. Because those goals also determine or reflect your horizon. What is horizon? Horizon is the time frame in which you seek to accomplish something. And so when you look at your time frame, if you say what I'm trying to do in 2 and 3 years, maybe this might not be the deal for you. If you say I'm trying to do it in 10, 15 years, maybe that's the deal for you. If you say you're trying to do it in 50 years, well, it may even be more so the deal for you. So really what matters is what your goals are, what your time horizons are. And then what also matters is what your risk profile is. Meaning two things in many ways. Meaning, what is your appetite for risk? And what is risk? Risk is the uncertainty about whether you will lose the investment that you are making in the future. Because none of us knows the future. And no investment is without risk. Some investments have more risk, some have modest risk, some have minimal risk, but no investment is without risk. So one has to know what one's appetite is for risk. Can I afford to lose any or all of this money that I'm investing? That's my investment appetite. There's also, though, your investment capacity. So some people might have an appetite for huge risk, but the nature of their financial position is that they really don't have no tolerance for that risk. They can't afford that risk. They cannot afford to lose that money because it is some... It may be their emergency fund, it may be their child's educational fund, and they just can't take that money, plow it into something where the risk says you could lose that all and you can't afford to do that. And so you have to look at your risk appetite and your risk tolerance. And all of those things put together, along with somebody might even look at, okay, what do you have in your financial arrangements now? Do you have an emergency fund in your financial arrangement? If you don't have an emergency fund in your financial arrangement, why are you putting money away in a thing that you may not be able to access quickly if you need it because you have an emergency? So you, basically, we want to start to have an emergency fund first. So if you don't have an emergency fund, then putting money away in an investment like land or something else is not as wise a thing to do as first building up your emergency reserves. Right? So somebody might look at your arrangement and say, okay, well, you already have your emergency fund built up. You seem to have a good budget where there's space in your budget between your expenses and your income to allow for some savings and investing. So let's take the monies from your savings, investings, and plow into these things. They might look at, okay, but you know, the truth is if you plow it into this cruise port, you might already be, you may already have that kind of a investment in your portfolio. And so maybe you're not strengthening the portfolio to make that investment, but maybe you don't. And maybe this is a good way to create that diversification in your investment portfolio. So yes, go ahead and do it. So there's a great deal of consideration that can go into whether you or me should make an investment that we make. And this is what professional investment advisors will take you through as they carry you through the process. But if you have some money that you can afford to to invest and can tolerate maybe that things don't go well or that it'll take a long time before this thing does turn into monies for you, either in the way of dividends or in the way of capital appreciation, then that's a consideration for you to make. And so on the face of it, I think it looks like a good prospect. It looks like a good prospect, but I've asked for and I've gotten the memorandum, the offering memorandum, and I'll read it and see further what it says. And I don't give you any investment advice, but I know certainly there are people like the people making the offering, C-File, that does, and others like Osborne SRF that does. And so you can look at those and see whether or not this fits with what you are striving to do in your life. So we're going to take a break. And when we come back, I'm asking you, the way your government addresses any particular problem or problems today, that's policy. If you could change any such policy today, what policy would you change? We'll be back after this break. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We'll be back.
Start the year making all the right money moves. Budgeting and saving? Yes. Investing? Check. But what if you could do more? With an RF brokerage account, you can get priority access to local investment opportunities right as they come to the market. Never miss a bond or new share offering again. Plus, you can house all your investments in one place and benefit from expert investment advice. Contact us at brokerage@rfgroup.com to start doing more today. Some conditions apply. RF, money at work.
Rev customers already get more channels, more sports, and more speed. Now, we're giving more Christmas with up to $250,000 in cash and prizes. Sign up or upgrade to Rev Trio to win prizes like rent and mortgage payments, trips to see your favorite sports teams, plus up to $20,000 in our Rev Cash Vault. Want to win more Christmas? Call 601-8992 today and ask for Rev Trio. Rev, you and us together.
Babe, you moshed the car?
I moshed the car. The lady who ran into me moshed the car.
I hope she had insurance.
If she had insurance, she hop out, pull out her phone, pull up the Royal Star Assurance app, and bang, she was on a video call with an RSA rep, sending pictures of her damage, my damage, filing a claim on the spot.
For real? Our insurance have that kind of app?
You gotta go to RSA for that.
Download the RSA app today or visit rsabahamas.com to submit your claim online. Live chat available weekdays 9 to 5.
This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Wednesday afternoon. If you want to call us today, the numbers to do so are 323-6232. That's 323-6232. Or you can call us on 325-4316, 325-4316, or 325-4259. That's 325-4259. You can also text us on 422-4796, or you can WhatsApp me on 439-3043. We're talking about policies of the government you would change today if you had a chance to change. We have a caller on the line. Go ahead, caller. We're listening to you. Hi, go ahead, caller.
Yeah, how are you today? Good afternoon.
Hey, I'm doing okay, man.
All right. Talking about policy change. I want to ask you just one or two questions before I answer.
Okay, sure.
About this policy change. Mr. Laing, I've been hearing a lot of stuff lately in the financial world that behemoth cannot open up a phone for a clearing bank. Could you answer that for me, please?
Cannot own a what?
A clearing bank, a banking system. Yeah, a clearing bank.
There is no law that says Bahamians cannot own any kind of bank in the Bahamas. You just have to meet the requirements of the Central Bank of the Bahamas in order to do so.
Okay, so how is it that
Bank of Bahamas is a clearing bank, and lots of Bahamians own a part of the Bank of the Bahamas.
Okay, and then I've been hearing some policies that you cannot bring in foreign borrowing money into the banking system to actually open up a business. Is that so?
That you can't bring in borrowed monies, foreign monies.
Foreign borrowed money, yes.
No, that is not true at all. In fact, the central bank changed that policy over the last 3 years such that you can borrow up to about $5 million.
Yeah.
$5 million to do so, yeah.
Oh, yeah, I know that they changed it recently because I've been hearing some stuff under the last administration. They were trying to change it 2 years into their administration, right?
Well, first of all, that has nothing to do with the administration. That's a central bank policy. If they want to change it, they can change it. If they want to create it, they can create it. The government can't do anything about that.
Okay, all right. Yeah, and then, what I would like to change is the policy when it comes to Crown Land. I would think it would have been much more across the board for the average man to get Crown Land if it was taken out of the office of the Prime Minister and have a committee and boards and all of that, so it could be more transparent. And it could be more in a way that and the average fellow could get some Crown Land or something like that. That's my policy.
Okay. So you would change the process of getting Crown Land.
Yes, change the process of it and make it more applicable to the average man instead of waiting 10, 15 years.
That's very good. Thank you. Thank you. Very, very, very good suggestion. Thank you, bro.
Yes.
Appreciate your calling. All right. We have a text here. Says good evening. One of those policies I would look to amend is that of zoning as it relates to being able to add on a one or two bedroom for rent to your home. Once the space and that. And that's because some have the ability to do that, but it is restricted from doing. But is restricted from doing so because of zoning laws. If I understand it correctly, you can only do that add-on if your property is zoned for it. Some can add on to what they already have, but can't do it from scratch. I think it would help those in that position. The position of not being able to do it from scratch to secure a little better for their future. All right. I don't know how Nassau works in particular, I should say, but I do believe that if it's like Freeport has where you have areas zoned for residential construction and commercial construction. And within the residential construction, you have areas that are zoned single family, single story, right? Or single family, right? They don't tell you could only do one story. Or they have where some areas where it is zoned only single story, so you can't go up one and two or three or so far. I don't know the specifics of it, but I know that that exists. I don't know what Nassau's situation is, but I do know that in order to add on to your place in a certain way, you have to get a permit from Public Works. So whatever the policy is, I'm not too sure, But I hear you. You're saying that whatever that policy is, you would like that policy to be amended because right now you find it restrictive. Okay, I got you. No problem. This text says, hey, hope all is well. I'm listening to your show. I spoke with someone from investments and they said that they are limiting individuals to $1,000 investment. Okay. I haven't looked at the offering. This is someone spoke to Claudia Thompson at Kalina Investments. That would be Kalina Financial Advisors, and they are limiting the individuals to $1,000 investments. Okay, that means that they're trying to get more people than not to be able to own in this investment. So that's not a very high bar, $1,000. So that should allow for a broad ownership. So whereas Anton was talking about this airy notion of tiered investments for people and the ordinary man, well, if you're allowing people to come in at $1,000 and you're limiting everybody to more than $1,000, you can't get more average and more accessible in too many ways than that, other than to load the money to $500 or something like that. I don't know. That's what I'm being told by someone they read or I believe is quite credible. So, you know, this text says, I would change the immigration policy regarding status of citizenship given to the children of illegal immigrants, whether it was one-sided or on both parents' side. If one of those parents was illegal, citizenship should not apply, sends the wrong message and encouraged illegals. It's contributing to the influx and ongoing problem of illegal immigrants influx into the country. Okay, wow. So this person is recommending that the immigration policy be changed to tighten the situation such that if one of your parents came to the Bahamas illegally, you could not be granted citizenship. Let me tell you something, but that would affect a whole heck of a lot of people. That's a strong policy change recommendation. Would you agree with that? this text says, good afternoon, sir. When will the cruise investment be able to purchase? Well, it launched today. It launched today, so you should be able to contact your broker. You could contact C. Fallendorf today, as I understand it, and get some information. Let me tell you where you can go to get some information. Go to www.bahamasinvestmentfund.net. Let me say it again. www.bahamasinvestmentfund.net. So you can go there and get some more information about what all is involved in investing in the Bahamas investment funds. You can register there in order to, when you get to that site, you're gonna have to register. So you're gonna have to submit your name and email address, accept the terms of registration, and then agree to those terms, and then you'll be able to get in to get the information, inclusive, I imagine, of perhaps registering yourself to take on that investment. You do realize that when you are investing in this way, they have to do a KYC on you, which is a know your customer. And so they do have to ask information that qualifies you as a bona fide investor. They don't want you to be a money launderer. They don't want you to be a terrorist, you know, all that kind of stuff. So they are required by law to do some things, some basic things, to get some information to ensure that you are known to them as a customer. You're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. When we come back, we continue our discussion. You're listening to Z Live. We'll be back after this break.
Whatever weather, cold or warm, At Fidelity, the holidays are all about family, spending time with loved ones, and being thankful for the little things in life. Worrying about bills should be the last thing on your mind, especially during the holidays. Let Fidelity help you get your bills under control. Fidelity can also get you started with a real savings plan that actually pays you interest. The only thing you need to think about is what you will do with the savings in your pocket this Christmas. Now that's what I'm talking about. Fidelity Bank is here for you this holiday season because you are family, and family is important to us.
In a year when hugs and happy smiles have been few and far between, Fresh Market knows just how important this holiday season is to everyone. We've made our list, we've checked them twice, all to ensure that your holiday meals are filled with fresh and delicious ingredients. Our produce departments are brimming with seasonal favorites, our delis and bakeries are filled with holiday sweets and treats, and our grocery aisles are stocked with all your favorite essentials. It's the best time of the year, and we're giving you Fresh for the Holidays.
Rev customers already get more channels, more sports, and more speed. Now, we're giving more Christmas with up to $250,000 in cash and prizes. Sign up or upgrade to Rev Trio to win prizes like rent and mortgage payments, trips to see your favorite sports teams, plus up to $20,000 in our Rev Cash Vault. Want to win more Christmas? Call 601-8992 today and ask for Rev Trio. Rev, you and us together.
Do you know you can get your business cards designed and printed for as low as 18 cents a card? If it's a poster you want, you can pay as little as $6 a square foot. If your print needs are short or long run, digital printing, wide format, or print consultation, call the best. Call Printmasters. Printmasters' goal is to provide its clients with the highest level of personal, professional service at an affordable price. Our state-of-the-art technology also makes working together efficient and easy. Laminations, business cards, flyers, posters, window and floor decals are just a few of the digitized print services offered at Printmasters. Call 302-2361, 302-2361, or visit us at the Nassau Guardian Building in Oaksfield. Print with the best. Print with Printmasters.
Start the year making all the right money moves. Budgeting and saving? Yes. Investing? Check. But what if you could do more? With an RF brokerage account, you can get priority access to local investment opportunities right as they come to the market. Never miss a bond or new share offering again. Plus, you can house all your investments in one place and benefit from expert investment advice. Contact us at brokerage@rfgroup.com to start doing more today. Some conditions apply. RF, money at work.
It's a different kind of Christmas, but everything's here.
Yes, everything is here at ShopSmart Department Stores. Two locations just for you. One on Mackey Street next to RBC and in the Prince Charles Shopping Plaza. Come on down. Everything is here.
At ShopSmart.
At ShopSmart.
At ShopSmart.
Oh, everything is here.
COVID-19 doesn't take holidays off, and neither should you. We can celebrate the holiday season while continuing to follow all public health protocols and regulations. We must also remember to wash our hands and sanitize frequently. Wear our masks, cough and sneeze into our elbows, disinfect items brought into our homes, stay at least 3 feet away from others in public, and remain at home when we're feeling unwell. Let's have a happy and healthy holiday.
This message brought to you by Bahamas Ministry of Health in conjunction with Guardian Radio.
I'm not afraid, I'm not afraid to take a stand, take a stand. Everybody, everybody, come take my hand, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm, whatever weather, cold or warm. Send you know that you're not alone. Holla if you feel like you've been down the same road.
Welcome back. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z-Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Wednesday afternoon. If you want to call us today, please feel free to do so on 323-6232 or 325-4316 or 325-4259. You can also text us on 422-4796, or you can WhatsApp me on 439-3043. Somebody sent me a silly text. It made me chuckle. But I want you all to know, I got born again today. I'm born again today. So I want you to know that I am putting silly and stupid on blast. So we're not reading any silly or stupid text anymore on the show. You are not going to text the show, and you are not going to insult anybody, me, anybody on the show. I can't help you. So save your energy and save your ink. Is not going to happen on the show, okay? All right. So we're talking about policies of the government of the Bahamas you want to change. You know, I have to say, so far, I'm a little surprised that more of you ain't texting in, because Bahamians complain on these shows every day. If you listen, I imagine that if you're an alien, and you start monitoring all the radio stations, all the newspapers in the Bahamas, if you start like eavesdropping on all the conversations in the Bahamas, I imagine that you would think that Bahamians think their country sucks. Let me ask my niece if that's true. I lie. I don't believe that if the alien was able to probe the hearts of Bahamians, they would think that Bahamians think that the country sucks, you know. I just think that if they listened to our conversations on the radio, they'd think that that's what we think. So I would think that given all the complaints that we have, especially when it comes to the government and politics and politicians, that there would be a great number of policies you would want to change. We had some good offerings so far, some folks who want to change immigration policy. Thank you very much. Some folks who want to change the crown land, not so much policy, because the policy does allow Bahamians to get crown land. That person wants to change the procedure such that it is less in the hands of the government, more in the hands of, say, a private or more third-party entity, and then to allow the process to be more transparent and sped up. And that's quite a thoughtful something, quite frankly, coming from that suggester. Okay, we do have some more suggestion, though. This person says, Mr. Laing, I read the comments of both Sir Franklin and former PM Hubert Ingram. Mr. Ingram is in order to explain his government's decision. In fairness to all, Mr. Samianto should give his side of the story, because it would appear as though he had no problem with the government decision, if what I am reading is right. You know, okay, I was going to go there maybe a little later, but no problems. I agree with you for the most part. But here's what I found when I read the story by Sir Franklin and Mr. Ingram, the comments by both. Sir Franklin said that what happened in 96, 97, those 2 years, in relation to a land sale in which the Samianto group was seeking to purchase land from Sir Franklin those. At the time, it's not Sir Franklin, Franklin Wilson those, right? He said that that deal didn't go through because it represented bad public policy. And it thrust Eleuthera into a recession. Well, first of all, Sir Franklin never qualified what he meant by bad public policy. What does that mean? I mean, like, public policy could be anything. What did he mean? What was the bad public policy? Was there a policy not to sell the land? Was there a law not to sell the land to a Bahamian? Was it a policy not to sell the land to allow a Bahamian to sell the land to a foreigner? Was the policy not to allow Sir Franklin or Franklin Wilson and his group there to sell the land to a foreigner? What was the policy? Was it a policy not to sell that Eleuthera piece of land? Was it a policy not to sell? What was the policy? We don't know. He just says it was bad public policy, right? And then he said, and bad governance. Well, what does that mean? Was it bad governance because You weren't allowed to sell your land. Was it bad governance? Because you shouldn't have to have a development plan for a property in order to sell it. What was the governance issue? He never defined it. He just threw it out there, but he never defined it. Mr. Ingram reacted to that, and I thought kind of curiously, because he reacted to it in a way that suggested he knew with some specificity what Sir Franklin was speaking to. Now, in fairness to Mr. Ingram, when you put it out there that was just bad public policy and bad governance, you make it general. So yes, I try to cover the scope of how we handled investment policies at that time. And I thought, and I think today, given what Mr. Ingram said, it is a legitimate policy perspective to have to say, if you, a foreigner, want to purchase land in the Bahamas of that much acreage, you need to have an investment proposal attached to a development proposal attached to it. And why would that not be sensible? When the Ingram administration came into office in 1992, it repealed the Immovable Properties Act and replaced it with the International Persons Landholding Act. And in the International Persons Landholding Act, this was the change that was made. It said that in order for you to purchase property of 5 acres or more as a foreigner, if you want to do some residence on it, you have got to apply to the investment board to do so. If you purchase property of less than 5 acres for residential purposes, that is to build a residence, you just have to register the purchase. You don't have to get permission or approval to do so. It says that no matter how much land you are purchasing for commercial purposes, no matter how much, you have to apply to the government for approval if you are a foreigner. So if you want to purchase an acre, you got to apply to the investment board to do so. And the investment board would require you to have a development proposal attached to that commercial investment, which goes on to the National Economic Council for consideration. Well, if you're going to purchase acres and acres and acres, then why would there not be a requirement for you to have a development proposal attached to it? You had already gotten a sum of land already to do your development. The government deemed that that amount of land you purchased was adequate for the development you said you wanted to do. And that's what you said you wanted to do. Now you come along and say, I want to purchase this additional land with no development proposal. And the government says, no, I'm not going to allow it to go through. So what is the bad policy? What's the governance? Was it a sense of prejudice? Was it a sense of victimization? What was it? So Franklin didn't say. So Mr. Ingram kind of covered the broad spectrum of public policy in that way. I do agree with that texter that if Mr. Samianto spoke, maybe he could give a perspective himself, because nothing I read suggested that he was here, that he shared the point of view of Sir Franklin, but that doesn't mean he didn't. It's just that nothing we have in the public domain today suggests that. So if he did comment, it might bring a perspective to the issue for sure. This text says, good day, sir. I would revisit the Bail Act and seek to raise the bail amount for serious crime or make. Also revisit the jail time given to offenders guilty of illegal guns and bullets. Okay, so here's a person who says, listen, now, what we do give for, you realize, listen to me, folks, I'm just raising this because you put it out there. You indicate that you would raise the amount of bail required for serious crimes. You do realize that what you're saying is this. Remember now, every person brought before the courts, is innocent unless proven guilty. Innocent. A bail application means I'm saying, I would like to have my freedom as an assumed innocent person until I am convicted. You realize that when you raise the bail, what you're saying is the poor has less chance, if they are innocent, of being able to enjoy their freedom until proven guilty than the rich have. So you charge bail of $200,000. The rich man who just got accused of murder, say no thingy, boom, see a check there, I'm gone, I'm free. The little boy, the young man from Beantown, Grahamstown, Pine Ridge, Marco City, Georgetown, Rollville, he can't afford $200,000, so where's he gonna be? In prison until trial. And guess what? He and the rich man have both been assumed innocent until proven guilty. So you just have to ask yourself, is that the policy you're really advocating for? I'm not saying you're wrong. I'm just saying, just putting it out there. And the same thing goes for jail time for guilty or illegal gun busts. Well, not the same thing, because if presumably the rich and the poor get the same time if the crime is and circumstances are the same. All right. So, but I hear your policy suggestion, and it's out there. Ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We're going to take a break from news, and when we come back, we'll continue our discussions. We'll be back after the news break.
I'm not afraid to take a stand, take a stand. Everybody, everybody, come take my hand, we'll walk this road together through the storm, whatever weather.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
If you like a hearty, meaty burger, the A1 Steakhouse King at Burger King Nassau has it all. With flame-grilled beef, lots of bacon, cheese, and crispy onions on a sesame seed bun, the only thing that can top this is the tangy flavor of A1 steak sauce. The Steakhouse King is a meat lover's dream, and with an ice-cold Pepsi and hot fries, it's all you need to fill your day. Get your A1 Steakhouse King as a combo or part of the new King's Feast, only at Burger King Nassau, where taste is king.
Sheila, you okay? I see smoke coming from your window.
Chad, Johnny Moe's burning down the house frying chicken.
Your kitchen is a mess. You have insurance?
If I have insurance, I pulled my phone out, pull up the Royal Star Assurance app, and in no time, I was on live chat with RSA rep, sent pics of the damage, filed my claim on the spot.
Wow, I don't think my insurance got that kind of app.
You got to go to RSA for that.
Download the RSA app today. Live chat available weekdays 9 to 5.
Food security is a challenge for many. Now in a pandemic, many more are unsure of their next meal. Through their Feed 5000 program and a $20,000 donation, AML is working to ensure that everyone has a meal for the holidays, and they're inviting you to help. Now until December 17th, visit any Solomon's, Costrite, Fresh Market, or Domino's in Nassau or Freeport, and Exuma Markets in Georgetown to donate and help feed a family in need this Christmas. No amount is too small. Remember, we're all in this together.
Are you on the move? Busy running errands? Do you have so much to do that you don't have a lot of time on your hands? Have you gotten your COVID-19 vaccine yet? Well, if you haven't, the Johnson & Johnson vaccine may be the one for you. It's one and done and fully vaccinated for now. Yes, you only need one jab of the Johnson & Johnson vaccine and you're done. Lower your risk of severe illness and death from COVID-19 by getting vaccinated. This message has been brought to you by the Ministry of Health and this radio station.
Come take my hand, we'll walk this road together through the storm.
Welcome back. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Wednesday afternoon, where I'm asking the question, really, if you could change any policy of the government of the Bahamas today, meaning any way the government behaves today to deal with any of the issues it deals with today, what policy would you change? What policy would you change? You beef with the government all the time, telling them they're doing things wrong. What would you change if you had the chance to change it today? Tell me what policy of the government of the Bahamas you would change. We already had some suggestions along those lines. You can text us at any of the following numbers, 323-6232. You can call us on 323-6232. That's 323-6232 or 325-4316, 325-4316, or 325-4259. That's 325-4259. You can also text us on 422-4796, or you can WhatsApp me on 439-3043. What would you do? You're always complaining about the Bahamas is too dependent on foreigners. Would you change that policy? What would you change in that policy? Would you let foreigners no longer participate in tourism? Would you let foreigners no longer participate in certain areas of the economy, no participation in agriculture? Or would you allow foreigners to participate in wholesale and retail trade? Would you allow them to participate more in foreign in construction? Would you allow them to participate in transportation, ground transportation, inter-island transportation? Would you allow them to participate in whole estate? What would you change if you had a chance to change? What about education? Would you extend school hours or would you shorten school hours? Would you increase the age limit for children to be in school or would you decrease it? What would you do in education? Would you allow local government to run their local schools or versus what the government now does? What would you change in the way of government policy? Would you let parliamentarians be full-time parliamentarians and pay them more? Or would you just keep it things as is? Would you keep the Queen as head of state? Or would you change that and become a republic or become communist or whatever else you would like to become? What would you change in the way of policy? Would you shift our policy from being more allied with the United States of America to being more allied with Asia, France, Germany, or what have you? Would you go and shift our policy to join the Caribbean single market and economy, or would you not? Would you shift our policy to join the WTO? Or would you say, no, let's stay out of the WTO? What policy would you change in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas? You got all these thoughts about how backward we are, about how we can't get it right, how all these other nations, Singapore and the Netherlands and all these people and do it right, but we can't do nothing right. You're bragging about Mia Motley all day long. What would you change? That's what I'm asking. So please, you let me know. I'm happy to hear from you. This text says, government must change its policy on taxation. See, somebody is thinking. No, all y'all complaining about taxing all day long and nobody talks about taxation. It says government must change its policy on taxation. The continuation of a regressive-only tax regime is untenable. Given the economic state of affairs, it is questionable whether without significant growth, any major movement shifts despite rebounds. Okay, there you go. Somebody says, and rightly so, can't argue with this person. We need to change our aggressive tax policy and change to a more progressive tax policy. You know what that means, right? That means you need to have income tax. At least one of the propositions on it is that's the most significant one, and a progressive corporate tax regime, right? That's what this individual is saying. What would you change? That's the question. I mean, would you keep the fixed exchange rate regime we have pegging our dollar to the US dollar as we have, or would you allow the Bahamian dollar to float? Would you change it? Would you change that policy? All right, that's what we're asking today. This text says, good afternoon, Mr. Laing. Thank you so much for raising the level of talk show dialogue, which encourages us as listeners to strive for excellence in our existence. With reference to the financial policy, which governs or allows the amount of interest and administrative charges applied on loans by the various clearing banks for there to be more parity or similarities to their customers in other countries or jurisdictions. Wow, okay. Now, that is an interesting policy change proposition because you are then asking for the government of Bahamas to intervene in the pricing mechanism of a private business. Now, let me tell you what that's like. That's like saying the government should say, well, you know, the rents you are charging in this particular area are too high for the average citizen in that area, and I therefore require you to keep bring your rent down. Can you do that? Would you like to do that? Now, you might argue that, yeah, that's something that really ought to be done also. I'm just saying. But thank you for a very clear statement of possible change that you would like to see. All right, no problem at all. We have some other text here. This text says, Kadesa, I would change the policy that allows foreigners to buy residential or commercial properties, especially on these small family islands. In Exuma, the foreigners are buying all the land, and when they buy it, us Bahamians will never own it again. That's an interesting policy proposition. That's interesting, given the small state of our islands, some of these islands and the limited land on some of these small islands. We should limit and or eliminate the possibility of foreigners purchasing land in those spaces. Okay. I could see a discussion around that policy. Thank you for being so thoughtful, folks. Goodness gracious me. This text says, I would change our tax structure, eliminate import taxes, and implement income tax, principally among other adjustments. Thank you. Very thoughtful. In other words, you're saying, listen, stop making the price of things coming into the country so high that's going to be taxing mostly the poor disproportionately, and let's tax income where we can progressively tax people greater with the greater means to pay. I got you. Boy, the government of Bahamas listening today, maybe they might get some thoughts about what policies they should be looking at today. This text says, I would change policy to limit the banking fees to match the fees in the home country again. Now, you see, I hear you, but is that fair? Because if the cost per unit here is higher than the cost per unit in the United States of America or Canada, because their population size allows them to have a smaller, lower per unit cost, why would you tax a business, limit a business's ability to recoup that cost? Now, I'm not saying these banks are charging these fees based on rational cost analysis. I'm just saying, though, to put in a policy where you say, I want you to charge what you charge elsewhere, that totally ignores all kinds of economic factors that could play into a business's cost structure. And that is true for foreign business and a Bahamian business. And if the government of the Bahamas want to do that for banks, they should look at that same thing for everything else, right? Why shouldn't the food in the food store match the price in the United States of America? You say, well, there's import taxes and shipping fees and all that kind of stuff. Yes, and I'm telling you that there are cost structures like utilities, electricity and the like, that on a scale basis is much lower in Canada and the United States than it is in the Bahamas. The risk profile of debtors in the United States and Canada on balance may be different than the risk profile here, so that the interest reflects that risk profile here. It's not as simple as that. I'm sorry. I can't. You would ask me to deny all my education and training in the area of economic finance and business to say to you that I would just buy outright the suggestion. But it's your suggestion. I'm just commenting on it. This text says, hi, I give each senior citizen a 10% discount at all businesses in the Bahamas from BPI, BTC, SuperValue. All businesses must give them a 10% just show their new senior citizen card. So you're saying the government of the Bahamas should be able to impose on all businesses that you have to give a senior citizen 10% discount. That you would pass a law requiring the government of the Bahamas, I mean, a law requiring every business, including the barbershop, to give a 10% discount to senior citizens. Mind you, I can't say that that's, I could see the generous, wonderful news that would be to senior citizens, but do you really want the government of the Bahamas to be in that business? Why not give to the average working person struggling to make a living a 10% discount on all rents? Where does it stop? Where does it end? Do you really want to do that? Or can the government get that discount at government-operated institutions where taxpayers, including those senior citizens, pay the taxes? Maybe that's a consideration that you can make. This text says, good afternoon, Mr. Laing. I would change the following policies. Get rid of VAT and duty taxes. Implement an equitable income tax. Okie dokie. This one says, two, allow Bahamians access to all sectors of the economy. At present, Bahamians cannot own a casino or play in a casino. All Bahamians should have access to own a casino and to play in a casino. Okay, all right, okay. That's a policy change for sure. This text says, I would change the exchange control policy. If I have the means to invest in the US stock market with my money, why should the government keep its boot on my neck and prevent me from building wealth? Well, it's not that you cannot. So don't say cannot. If you change the policy, you change how you do it. Because you can still invest on the US stock market now. You can go through your local brokers to do so, and they have to go to the central bank, or you can apply yourself to go to the central bank to do so, and the central bank may or may not permit you to do so, all right? So it's not that you can't, it's the limitations on the procedures to do so. And those procedures have been liberalized some over time, but it is possible. So you want to change the extent to which you are able to do so, so that you are able to do so more freely than exists today. This text says, this is why Atlantis had to give all Bahamian shareholders a refund a few years ago when Bahamians temporarily owned shares in Atlantis. Why did they have to give them a refund? I don't know about that, but tell me, I really missed that. Maybe I missed that. This text says that I would change the age of sexual consent. It should be raised to 18. Any adult who has sex with a 17 and 16-year-old should face the same prison time as an adult who has sex with a 15-year-old or under. Okay, all right. Okay, I hear you. This text says, you know, that debate over the age of consent, it hasn't always been an easy debate. When we come back, I'll talk about it. Some more. You're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We'll be back after this break.
I'm not afraid. I'm not afraid to take a stand. Take a stand. Everybody, everybody, come take my hand. Come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm. Whatever weather, cold or warm, let me know that you're not alone. Holla if you feel like you've been down the same road.
Start the year making all the right money moves. Budgeting and saving? Yes. Investing? Check. But what if you could do more? With an RF brokerage account, you can get priority access to local investment opportunities right as they come to the market. Never miss a bond or new share offering again. Plus, you can house all your investments in one place and benefit from expert investment advice. Contact us at brokerage@rfgroup.com to start doing more today. Some conditions apply. RF, money at work.
Sheila, you okay? I see smoke coming from your window.
Chad, Johnny Mo's burning down the house frying chicken.
Your kitchen is a mess. You have insurance?
If I have insurance, I pulled my phone out, pulled up the Royal Star Assurance app, and in no time, I was on live chat with RSA rep, sent pics of the damage, filed my claim on the spot.
Wow, I don't think my insurance got that kind of...
You gotta go to RSA for that.
Download the RSA app today. Live chat available weekdays 9 to 5.
Food security is a challenge for many. Now, pandemic, many more are unsure of their next meal. Through their Feed 5000 program and a $20,000 donation, AML is working to ensure that everyone has a meal for the holidays, and they're inviting you to help. Now until December 17th, visit any Solomon's, Cost-Rite, Fresh Market, or Domino's in Nassau or Freeport, and Exuma Markets in Georgetown to donate and help feed a family in need this Christmas. No amount is too small. Remember, we're all in this together.
Are you on the move? Busy running errands? Do you have so much to do that you don't have a lot of time on your hands? Have you gotten your COVID-19 vaccine yet? Well, if you haven't, the Johnson & Johnson vaccine may be the one for you. It's one and done and fully vaccinated for now. Yes, you only need one jab of the Johnson & Johnson vaccine and you are done. Lower your risk of severe illness and death from COVID-19 by getting vaccinated. This message has been brought to you by the Ministry of Health and this radio station.
Do you know you can get your business cards designed and printed for as low as 18 cents a card? If it's a poster you want, you can pay as little as $6 a square foot. If your print needs are short or long run, digital printing, wide format, or print consultation, call the best. Call Printmasters. Printmasters' goal is to provide its clients with the highest level of personal, professional service at an affordable price. Our state-of-the-art technology also makes working together efficient and easy. Laminations, business cards, flyers, posters, window and floor decals are just a few of the digitized print services offered at Printmasters. Call 302-2361, 302-2361, or visit us at the Nassau Guardian Building in Oaksfield. Print with the best. Print with Printmasters.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
I'm not afraid, to take a stand, Everybody, come take my hand, We'll walk this road together through the storm, whatever weather.
Welcome back. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo, and I'm your host. I'm so glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Wednesday afternoon. If you want to give us a call today on the show, the numbers to do so are as follow. You can call us on 323-6232. That's 323-6232 or 325-4316, 325-4316, or 325-4259. That's 325-4259. You can also text us on 422-4796, or you can WhatsApp me on 439-3043. We're talking about policies of the government of the Bahamas you would change. I have to say, I'm so impressed, so thankful, so grateful to you as you share your thoughts. Some of you are absolutely thinking through these things and offering some interesting policy suggestions. I'm going to keep these notes because I think that as we move along in discussions and developments, they may prove quite useful as ideas. But we were talking about the suggestion of raising the age of consent. I want you to know that governments of the Bahamas have had this dialogue. They have. I know I have been a part of a government having this dialogue. And it's not as simple as you think. It really is not. You know, I want you to consider this. Do you honestly believe that a 15-year-old and a 16-year-old cannot have a legitimate interest in each other in terms of intimate interest? Really seriously, that a 15 or 16-year-old cannot or might not be mature enough to understand their own feelings, their own intent to say, I really like you as a person for all the reasons I like you as a person. And then when you think that that is possible, to think that it is conceivable that these people who are human beings, who at that age have hormones that can kick in to lead them to feel a sexual attraction to each other that might lead to intimate relations, consent-wise by each other. You really, really believe that those two people in that circumstance, having agreed to have sexual relations with each other, did not give consent, and therefore it was in effect rape? That the term we want to apply to what has happened is statutory rape for those two young people. I'm not talking about no grown man, you say sleeping with a 15-year-old now, because we like to find the extremes to validate why we want to do a certain something. But let's take into consideration these two 16-year-olds who have decided, and you and I both know, over the course of our history, I'm a young man. I went to schools. I know young people. And I know plenty of young people who agreed to have sexual relations with each other, and they were not 17. They were not 18. Agreed to do so. Full, discussed it, talked about it, got the condoms and everything to do it. You really believe that if they get caught, because some parent got angry, some guardian got angry, that if they get caught, and even if the lady or somebody else got angry and wanted to change it around and say it was rape, but it was proven not to be rape but consensual, you really believe that the law should say that should be called rape? Rape now. I'm not suggesting we can't find another word for it. Like, we could say it ain't rape, because I had two ladies on my show who said, listen, rape is about force, about power. If these two young people decided to go ahead and have this act that was discovered maybe by somebody, a parent or guardian who decided this is rape, right? Are we really saying that that is forceful use of power, as opposed to, let's say, we put a provision in the law that says they had ill-advised sexual relations, and then we give that a different application in the law in terms of punishment, maybe community service or something like that. So I don't have a problem if we want to try to discourage early sexual relations because of all the risk that could be involved. Because yes, there could be young people on balance who don't think through these issues as intelligently or as maturely as they can. But rape? Really? Statutory rape? That's the best we could do? Coming out of a colonial system in today's modern world, as opposed to these people have been put before juvenile court and charged with ill-advised sexual relations, and only brought there because the parents of them agreed that they should come before the court or before the juvenile court to ensure that they understand the serious risk that they were taking to themselves. That's my 5 cents. That's my 5 cents, right? But that's a suggestion somebody had on the age of consent. We have some more text here. He got a ton of text here. Try to get to them because I want to hear your thoughts. This text says, Bahamians should be allowed to purchase shares in the stock market much easier. Okay, we got you, says that individual. Okay, let me get to these. This text says, so you might as well just don't ask people to comment if you think only your ideas make sense. Why not just come up with your own biased, closed-minded ideas? But I'm not, But I'm not refuting people's ideas. I'm just speaking some perspectives on the idea. You're just too sensitive, right? And quite frankly, it's kind of like really just kind of little petty to suggest that I'm suggesting that these people are not bad ideas, because lots of people gave ideas and I just told them, wonderful. And some of them I commented on just to give a perspective on it. If you can't take that, you know exactly what you can do to help yourself. I mean, I understand. All right, this text says, lease the land even if for 50 or 100 years and not sale. Case in point, Bahama, Hilton, and others. So you wouldn't give outright allow. Remember now, all these lands by these foreign companies aren't given to purchase from the government, you know. Not all of them. Some of them are purchased from private owners. So are you saying that private owners shouldn't be able to sell their land? They should only be able to lease the land out? Or are you saying when it's government land, the government shouldn't sell it? They should only be able to lease, because Bahamas land was not altogether government land, okay? Or the Hilton. The Hilton was owned by private owners before the government, all right? This text says, this land is my land, this land is your land, this land was made for you and me. We signed this in primary school, remember? Yeah, but the land you build your property on, your house on, ain't my land, that's your land. That ain't our land, that's your land. That's why it's called real estate. No, it's called real estate because unlike some of them virtual estates, this is like what we call tangible property. This text says, good day, Mr. Laing. We need to change the law on fishing, because if I pay for permits to bring persons who can dive for me and catch my fish and pay them for their labor, just like bringing in nurses, chiefs, hotel managers, et cetera, this is legal. What does the casino bring to the Bahamas as far as foreign exchange is concerned? Well, if you imagine that all the tourists who are gambling in the casino are bringing their money from away to gamble, then they are bringing that foreign exchange in there. Some of that foreign exchange is going to be used to pay the salaries of employees, to pay utility bills and all that kind of stuff. And so the net effect to you is some foreign reserves building up in the country, right? This text says, hi, Mr. Laing. I would like for us to create a policy where land is only sold to non-Bahamians to build homes. Any land for business should be leased. Just in case the business folds up, we still own the land. Okay, see, that's that person saying, no commercial land sold, just lease. Wow. It'd be interesting to see what impact that would have on how foreigners view investing in the Bahamas, but that's a very interesting offering, I think. This text says, very insightful show today. Thank you very much. Okay. Says, Mr. Laing, I truly believe that God has you at this time to be our Moses, to lead us into the promised land, to take the Bahamas to a level that we all can appreciate. I pray that you would continue to educate us and open our eyes to the reality. I truly appreciate listening to you on the radio. In fact, that's when I take my lunch break, just to learn so much knowledge about our country and life itself. Thank you, thank you, and thank you. God bless. Sorry I missed the earlier part of your show, was not sure of your topic today. I appreciate your saying so. That's very high praise. Thank you very much. But we try to do what we can do. Just remember that at the end of the day, the way your government impacts you, the way your government improves or worsens your life, is by way of its policies, the way it addresses the issues and the problems that you have. Now, it has been the case over the course of our independent history, well, even in our independent history, because we were not a nation, we were not at least a state prior to 1973, July 10th. But since that time, it has been in the earliest days, very likely that government implemented policies really only by doing so with narrow discussions among the policymakers, really the politicians. As time went on, there was more and more consultation. It could still be argued, and I think validly so, that there is still not enough consultation. But if public policy doesn't reflect input from the public, it is not likely that that public policy is ever going to be as strong as it needs to be. If public policy doesn't represent diverse points of view, what we call cognitive diversity, chances are you won't get the strongest public policy. If public policy continues to be jaundiced only by one partisan political perspective, we're not going to get the strongest public policies that we need to get. If public policy is guided more so by, well, if you did it, I ain't going to do it, or I do it, you're not going to do it, that's not going to allow us to have prevail the strongest public policy. But at the end of the day, however the government gets in your bedroom, gets in your bathroom, gets in your front room, gets in your yard, gets in your roads, gets in your neighborhood, gets in your communities, gets in your hospital bills, gets in your hospital attendance, gets in your relationship between you and your doctor, gets in the relationship between you and your lawyer, gets in between the relationship between you and your banker, gets in between the relationship between you and your landlord, gets in between the relationship between your teachers and your students, and you and your you and your students' teachers. All these ways in which the government gets in your business, it gets in your business through policy. And that policy might be written or it might be unwritten. That policy might be formal or it might be informal. That policy might be codified, meaning it is in law, or it might be uncodified. But in all these ways, the government of the Bahamas and any government affects you. And so that's why I wanted to stress to you today this notion of public policy, its impact, and why you and I should and continue to be thinking about what it is about the public policies of the country that we may or may not want to see adjusted. You're listening to Z Live. We're going to take our final break. And when we come back, we will continue our conversations. We'll be back after this break.
Like a hearty, meaty burger, the A1 Steakhouse King at Burger King Nassau has it all. With flame-grilled beef, lots of bacon, cheese, and crispy onions on a sesame seed bun, the only thing that can top this is the tangy flavor of A1 steak sauce. The Steakhouse King is a meat lover's dream, and with an ice-cold Pepsi and hot fries, it's all you need to fill your day. Get your A1 Steakhouse King as a combo or part of the new King's Feast, only at Burger King Nassau, where taste is king.
In a year when hugs and happy smiles have been few and far between, Fresh Market knows just how important this holiday season is to everyone. We've made our list, we've checked them twice, all to ensure that your holiday meals are filled with fresh and delicious ingredients. Our produce departments are brimming with seasonal favorites, our delis and bakeries are filled with holiday sweets and treats, and our grocery aisles are stocked with all your favorite essentials. It's the best time of the year, and we're giving you fresh for the holidays.
Rev customers already get more channels, more sports, and more speed. Now, we're giving more Christmas with up to $250,000 in cash and prizes. Sign up or upgrade to Rev Trio to win prizes like rent and mortgage payments, trips to see your favorite sports teams, plus up to $20,000 in our Rev Cash Vault. Want to win more Christmas? Call 601-8992 today and ask for Rev Trio. Rev, you and us together.
Start the year making all the right money moves. Budgeting and saving? Yes. Investing? Check. But what if you could do more? With an RF brokerage account, you can get priority access to local investment opportunities right as they come to the market. Never miss a bond or new share offering again. Plus, you can house all your investments in one place and benefit from expert investment advice. Contact us at brokerage@rfgroup.com to start doing more today. Some conditions apply. RF, money at work.
COVID-19 doesn't take holidays off, and neither should you. We can celebrate the holiday season while continuing to follow all public health protocols and regulations. We must also remember to wash our hands and sanitize frequently. Wear our masks, cough and sneeze into our elbows, disinfect items brought into our homes, stay at least 3 feet away from others in public, and remain at home when we're feeling unwell. Let's have a happy and healthy holiday.
This message brought to you by Bahamas Ministry of Health in conjunction with Guardian Radio.
I'm not afraid, to take a stand.
Welcome back. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Wednesday afternoon. If you want to give us a call at all and the remaining moments of this show, you can do so on any of the following numbers: 323-6232. That's 323-6232 or 325-4316, 325-4316 or 325-4259. That's 325-4259. You can also text me on 422-4796. That's 422-4796. Or you can WhatsApp me on 439-3043. We're talking about policies of the government of the Bahamas, the way the government does things that you may want to see change. We've gotten some great suggestions of things people would like to see change. This text says, good afternoon. I think the government needs to introduce a policy allowing Bahamians to own and gamble in casinos, okay? So that's two sets of people who are looking for a policy to allow Bahamians to own and gamble in casinos. I quite frankly don't see why Bahamians cannot today own. Let me help you also understand something about the casino business in the Bahamas. No foreigner owns a casino in the Bahamas, okay? What happens is they own the building and they own the operation, but the license is actually owned by the government. And so the government only allows them to operate the casino, right? So at the end of the day, they still take the money home, but the government doesn't. You don't get a perpetual license that you have and you own it and so forth and so forth. It's the government's license. It's much like a taxi license. You know, the taxi drivers don't own the license. They don't have a franchise in it. They really only, they kind of lease the license from the government. The government owns the license, right? It's like your passport. You don't own your passport. You say, this is my passport, but the truth of the matter is that's a government property. That's why when you lose it, you have to go and report it to the police. If you lose your NIB card, you have to go and report it to the police because you don't really own it, right? This text says, where can I find some structured beginners on public policy? There are lots of online courses or online articles and the like that you can get information on public policy. There's a couple of books I can direct you to. But there's lots of material. There's lots of videos on public policy that could help strengthen your awareness, understanding of public policy. And I think that's a great thing to do. At some point, we hope, the University of the Bahamas has courses in public policy as well, right? Under the political science regime. This text says, Zhivargo, I agree with the ill-advised sexual relations charge, but I think this should be limited to teens within 3 years of each other in age, and they can be ordered to take a sex education class where they are advised about STDs and birth control, et cetera. That's an excellent point. Excellent point. Excellent point. Yeah, so we're going to refine the policy such that, okay, we'll have some limits on what this ill-advised sexual relations is and so forth and so forth. And, once you get caught, it's going to require you to go do some things like take some courses on STDs and birth control and also on childcare, on parenting, Because some of these things could lead to, even with the best of intentions, outbreak controls measures aren't 100% proof other than abstinence. So maybe some parenting classes you could be ordered to. So just in case you end up in that situation, you can take care, better care, of the child that you father and mother, right? This text says they may have the emotional maturity, but the dependence is still on the parents if something happens like a baby. Yes, I agree with you. But are you suggesting to me that you're suggesting to me that my parents, if I had sexual relations with a woman at six, with a 16-year-old girl when I was 16, if caught, would want me hauled before the courts to be charged with rape, even if it's called statutory rape? You think my parents would prefer to have that on my record because they say, well, in any event, you're still dependent on me? You really think that that is true? Does that dependence lessen because it's now statutory rape? And since we have the statutory rape provision, don't we still have these young people being charged with statutory rape? And aren't the parents still dependent? So I don't know, man. All I'm saying is we should rethink that, right? And we could say, is it not better for that person, having learned some lessons, to have that they were placed before a juvenile council for ill-advised sexual relations, as opposed to having to report to an employer that I was charged with statutory rape? And when the employer hears the circumstances was that this was my girlfriend, we really liked each other, we were dating for about 3 years in high school, we didn't have sexual relations until we went into 12th grade when we were about to graduate, but now I'm still charged with statutory rape? No, man. We got to be a wiser, more mature society than that. Especially with God being had to all the stuff that's going on in our world today. We got to be. Listen to me. If we can change on so many other cultural, moral issues in our lives, surely on something like that, we could show some more grace. Come on, people, wake up, wake up. Let's not embrace this religious and moral rigidity that doesn't speak to grace, right? That doesn't help. That's all I'm saying. Anyways, I didn't give you too many. Some wise Alec talked about my thinking, only my ideas. I didn't really give any ideas today at all. My ideas were not the issue today at all. I did not want to get caught up in my ideas at all. One of these days I'm going to do a show. I mean, just one entire show on haters. I said, I'm going to do just one show. And you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to let the haters come and hate. Because here's my philosophy. I'm thinking that if we give a day for haters to hate and they can get it out of their system, maybe all the rest of the days of the year, they stop hating. That's my 5 cents on the issue, right? Anyways, I think you would agree that there are lots of policies in the Bahamas that work. You say, well, give me an example of one. Well, I would say to you that the policy of the Bahamas to offer free and compulsory education to all citizens of the Bahamas is a policy that has worked for the Commonwealth of the Bahamas insofar as advancing education in the country. I would suggest that. I would suggest that the policy of allowing for scholarship opportunities for children who meet a certain criteria to the College of the Bahamas, the University of the Bahamas, and likewise, I think that's a policy that works in the Bahamas. I think that by and large, our policy toward allowing foreign investors into the country has worked for the economic development of the country. Even if it hasn't worked if it hasn't worked perfectly, it has worked. I think it works. I think that the policy in the Bahamas that has tended to punish certain kinds of behavior over time has worked for us. Like what? Smoking. We are one of the least smoking societies on the planet. I think that policy works. So we have policies in this country that work. I think that our adoption of democracy as a governmental system, that's a policy that has worked for us. It hasn't worked against us. I think that that works for us. I think that our policy of aligning ourselves more often than not over the years with the United States of America, our closest neighbor, has been in our favor rather than not, giving us one of the few privileges enjoyed by countries anywhere in the world and things like preclearance and the like that has facilitated our tourism and what have you. I think that that has worked for us. I also think that our policy of training rigidly and aggressively our civil servants and police officers have helped us over time. We don't have a perfect system. We don't have a perfect service. We may need to do lots of work in it, but by and large, it has enabled us to have a service that maintains institutions in the country that works. I think national insurance as a policy mechanism in the country is one that works. It allows some social safety net for the country, and I think that it works. So we have had and we have many policies in the country that actually work. And the fact that you cherish your country, the fact that you think that the country is so cherished that we should protect it from these people and the next people, says something to me about a number of policies in the country that has enabled it to be what it is. It means that they work. But there are lots of these that also need tweaking or need to be gotten rid of or need to be improved. And that's what we have to work on. That's what we have to focus on. We have to try and do our best, get the ideas necessary to develop better policies. This text says, I would also make it illegal to smoke in public areas just like the USA. I think, if I'm not mistaken, I don't know about public areas, but I know at the airport or smokers, eh? Or something like that. But okay, I could get on board with that. This text says, outlaw shock treatment for children 16 years old can consent. Outlaw shock treatment for children 16 years old. I don't understand that. Says, I won't be surprised if a few Epstein Islands are in this country because we love protecting rapists, murderers, sexual offenders. Shake my head. That's a very, to me, I'm going to say it outright. That's just a stupid statement to me. You are ignorant to believe anyone in this country loves to protect rapists, murderers, sexual offenders. That's a stupid thing to say. Let me say that. I'm going to tell you that again. It's a stupid thing to say. You are just hurt because somebody disagrees with you. So you grab at the ridiculous. Carry on. This text says, we are among three nations in the world that doesn't have marital rape laws, one being a Muslim nation. We're a nation of followers. I don't know how marital rape, marital, I agree that that's a policy that we may need to change. Marital rape. Okay, I agree with you on that. But I mean, and my agreement don't mean that. I'm just saying, I agree with you on it. This text says, hey, while I understand the point about not making it statutory rape, but I too would like to see the age of consent raised. For a lot, that level of emotional entanglement demands a lot from our young people and a certain level of maturity to manage to fall out and fall in that I do not see enough of us. Mind you, it's lacking in the older amongst us as well. I was going to say that because age doesn't guarantee that you achieve any particular level of maturity. It only suggests that you do. Says, it's lacking in older amongst us as well. Not sure how we handle it, but they can't vote, not regarded as an adult. If they wish to disobey God's law, then at least be mature, able to deal with any consequences of their actions. First of all, nobody can show me in scripture any age on consent. No one can show me. I have read the Bible from Genesis chapter 1, verse 1 to Revelations, and I'm not seeing where the Bible talks about age of consent. What the Bible tends to put, at least in the New Testament, sex in is within the context of marriage. And it doesn't say how old you have to be to get married. So I don't know that if they're going to disobey the Bible, And who says who is mature? Who says when you are mature? I do believe that it could be useful to correlate age of consent with the age to vote, and then adjust the situations where a judge might say to somebody, well, this was a statutory rape, this was really ill-advised sexual relations. I could see that. But I don't know about the notion of age related to either maturity or to what scripture says is what is doable or not doable for people having sexual relations. Anyways, folks, I'm plumb out of time, and I want to thank you for your participation today. It's been great, been full of enjoyable. This text is not age, the law of fornication. Yes, you're right, not age stipulated. In fact, we have a law on the books that says 18 years can marry. Exactly, right? Anyways, wonderful discussion. I'm sure we can have it again. You've been listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. You all have a great evening. Nahaja Black is up next. God bless you. We'll talk to you again tomorrow.